How many people had ransomware? Be honest and don't be shy. All right, thank you. Very brave. At least one hand here. I totally know that there's more of you in here. All right? But the clue is that we have had these ransomware attacks, and now with crypto mining and crypto jacking attacks, what we see is that the ransomware is very specifically motivated not to be a pain in the ass to you, but just to use all of your processing power and your bandwidth to mine for cryptocurrencies. It's not bad. It's a good living. And then, you know, you still have the traditional banking issues. So you, because we're improving EMV and chip transactions, you still have a lot of fraud happening with card not present. So that's still dominating, including skimming. So when countries do get their stuff in order, the countries that have not managed to will still be exploited in order to still do skimming and those kinds of transactions. Point of sales devices. I thought this was really neat from last year. So point of sales are, I should show you like the pictures, but point of sales have actually been manipulated to almost a horrible thing, and there are still customers that think it must be fine and put their card in. You know, there's an entire skimming mechanism on that point of sale. So it's, they're being manipulated, and then what do malified businessmen do? They take those points of sales, and then they use it to acquire new card information. They just get a point of sale, hook it up, you know, fake company, get the card information, and move merrily on. Finally, when we look at, like, the newest stuff, what we see is that, like, a lot of the places where the money is, so the cryptocurrency market themselves, are targeted because, well, there's the money, and the users of the cryptocurrencies, which are sometimes are also criminal, are being very aggressively targeted by other criminals. So it's criminals going after other criminals to get the money. So both the actual cryptocurrency users as well as the exchanges that they're reliant on are also being attacked. And we see that, like, you know, the darknet markets, which were once so prevalent to buy anything from cocaine to malware to hitmen to kill your ex-boyfriend, those types of places are very unstable. Not just because Europol, working together with the FBI, has taken them down, but also because, again, here, there is no honor amongst thieves. So these marketplaces are being used with exit scams. They have wallets where they have a sort of escrow service to the buyer and the seller. Then the marketplace says, you know what, I'm just going to take all the money that's in this wallet and keep it for myself and an exit. So there's a lot of problems with these darknet markets. And if we take a look, okay, so we see what the impact is, we see, you know, these are the kinds of threats that are happening, who's actually doing it? Take a look in your spare time. I just got this. This is the latest edition of the Cyber Most Wanted of the FBI. There's roughly 69 people on that list right now, but we're just going to talk about a few of them. So hackers are always going to hack, always. And they usually hack for fun, profit, and politics, and usually escalate in that order. They start out thinking it's fun, they realize they can make money, and then once they figure that out, there's an idealistic motivation of why to hack. And what we see is, you can't tell the difference all the time when you try to study what they're doing, because there's a trickle-down effect of these hacking groups. So the most sophisticated hackers start off, but then the least sophisticated wind up using the same tools and tricks and attributes. So when we look at this, trying to actually figure out who these people are is pretty much the holy grail of cybersecurity. It's all about trying to figure out appropriate and accurate attribution. So if we just take a look at two of these actors a little bit more in detail, we're going to take a look at the first, number one. I thought you guys would like that because they're both very financial related. So we're going to look at number one, which is Gojnim, and we're also going to take a look at number 29. Park Jin-hook. Does anybody know who Park Jin-hook is? Any reason why he's on that list? Just out of curiosity. He's part of the biggest bank heist in history, which totaled losses of more than $1 billion. It's not bad. It's a pretty good living. So, unless you marry Jeff Bezos, in which case it's chip change. But The clue is that these are very interesting attacks. And when we take a look at why are these attacks happening, you know, we see all these criminals, we see what's happening, we see who's doing it. Now, why? Well, it's basically because we have a ton of vulnerabilities. And we also have a ton of security incidents. And both of these things present to an attacker a window of opportunity. When that window is left open, when there's a large amount of time between when a vulnerability comes out and when it's patched, or when there's an incident happening and it's closed, that's when the hacker says, aha, I can crawl in. We leave this exposure available. But rest assured, hardware and software vendors are doing everything they possibly can, their very best, to ensure that you all, we all, have privacy and security by design.